Jan, Greg Grant. This is for you. Thank you for allowing us to be here tonight.
Of estate residential everywhere, or just those three enclaves. I still don't. All of that is just about the stigma that somebody looking to buy property on speculation might
just want to come say hello to you.
Hello, the meeting has begun, sir.
Estate residential, and then in the communities that don't have the infrastructure or like they have.
Must be coming
in. All right. I was just afraid because there were just those three little enclaves. Now the commission might say, you know, why even have that? Unless you got five, why have one? You know, good to see you as well.
I'd like to call the search day, March 15th, Forsyth County Board of Commissioners meeting back to order. Come out of executive session, and chair entertains a motion to reconvene the regular public hearing.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. There's no discussion. Please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. I should have said all commissioners are present. The time is 5:02 that we start here. Next item is the invocation and pledge tonight. I think I'll read this first, and then we'll do the invocation, and then after the invocation, we'll have the Boy Scouts here and do what they're going to do. But we are pleased tonight, members of Troop 1099 of the Boy Scouts of America will be presenting the colors. Troop 1099, which has more than 70 Scouts on their rolls, is chartered at the Lanier United Methodist Church, and this year they are celebrating their 10th anniversary. David Johnson serves as their scoutmaster, and Dick Klein serves as the troop committee chairman. In addition to presenting the colors and leading the Pledge of Allegiance tonight, several of the scouts are working on their citizenship and the community merit badge. At this time, I would ask that you please stand as you're able for the invocation, and please remain standing for the presentation of the colors and Pledge of Allegiance. Your Heavenly Father, thank you for looking down upon all of us. Please provide protection for each and every one of us and allow us to continue to be successful and thrive as you have so far. Special protection or special consideration and care for those who are overseas protecting this country and all of us, and also for those who are in the line of service, such as the firemen, policemen, etc., who attempt to and do a great job of protecting us every day. Please help us to make good decisions for the rest of the county and in general, look down and bless Forsyth County. Amen. Scouts post the color, please.
Color guard advance. Color guard post the colors. Please join us in the Pledge of Allegiance. Stop, smooth.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Scouts of Troop 1099. Adoption of the agenda. Are there any changes to the agenda?
Mr. Chairman, yes, I do have one issue. Public hearing number one, request by Ethan Underwood on behalf of K.M. Holmes, LLC, to amend zoning conditions on Z-8-30-82. This is a, as I mentioned, a zoning condition amendment. The information, the file is updated, and that file update was submitted to the engineering department on the 7th of this month. Being in the close proximity of that date to this meeting, I am recommending postponement of that application, and I ask you to consider that.
Is it about postponement to what date?
Next available meeting.
That equal to that?
I'll make a motion to postpone. Yeah, let's see, that'll be public hearing, looks like number one, to April 5th, 2012.
Is that okay with both, or second for discussion? Is that okay with both applicants?
It's not, but they have apparently there's a, and they've explained it better than I can, but the engineering had to get involved in this on a lake, and because of the proximity of the time of the first application to what they're trying to work out now, there's not enough time. So our directors are asking for a postponement to the next available public hearing.
It's okay with the board, with Mr. Underwood, you want to address that? Is that okay with the board, Mr. Commissioner?
Thank you, Commissioner. I just want to address that public comment. This is fine. The difficulty is on March 1st, at the last hearing, we had met with neighbors and worked out some last minute changes. We also were notified on March 1st, which was your last meeting, that the engineering department wanted some supplemental information. We said fine, so we postponed it to the 15th. And then submitted that information as quickly as we could. It was my understanding was that it was approved on the 5th of March. Mr. Brown's information is it was submitted on the 7th. In any case, let's assume it was approved on the 7th. Mr. Brown expressed concerns from saying, well, that's fairly close to the hearing, and I understand that. The code does not allow modifications once the application is deemed complete. However, the modifications were made at the request of the engineering department. We wouldn't have submitted any additional information if the engineering department hadn't asked for that to try to supplement it. We certainly don't want to not be responsive to that. My experience has been the county's policy is whenever the county asks for more information and that's provided, that's not deemed a change that causes a postponement. And in any case, as the application can't be changed unless deemed completed, if the engineering department didn't deem the application complete until that information was submitted, then upon submittal, that's when no change can be made. So we're certainly have been above board. We've met with neighbors, and the information's been available to the public. But we're very anxious simply because we've got a contract deadline. The deadline is actually tomorrow on the due diligence period. What we're asking for is that you consider, we want you to abide by the code, but we believe that what we're requesting to be able to go forward is a modification requested by the engineering department. It's in keeping with the county's policies and practices, and we think that the information has been available to allow folks to have the opportunity to review the request that we have to go forward. Thank you.
Right. Mr. Donovan, was the engineering department allowed enough time before March 5th to review it, or was this shortage of time coming on March 7th?
The application was submitted in January. The engineering department began reviewing at that time. There were some modifications. What we found, we had originally asked for a stream buffer variance to facilitate four lots. And what we found, if we're allowed to present, I'll go into further detail, but we didn't need to impact all four lots. There are large trees that we want to preserve on the site, and we only need to impact two lots. Well, when you're only impacting two instead of four, you have to supplement that information to the engineering department, which we did on March 1st. At that point, it was when the engineering department said, we still need some more information, which is what we're going to provide. So yes, there has been ongoing correspondence and review by the engineering department. The final proposal was much less intense than what was originally proposed back in January, but we had to tweak it and make sure everything, all the plans matched the new plan, which was to impact the two lots instead of four. And that's why the request for additional information is.
Deadline is when? Tomorrow?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Brown, is there any way that was the previous plan approved through engineering and you went with less impact now? Or is it just
did not receive a notice from the engineering department that the previous plan had been approved? Okay.
Is there any way that, I mean, we don't want to jeopardize their contract. Is there any way?
What I can tell you is moving forward with this application, I would not view as a violation of our zoning ordinance. The ordinance sets a standard that there are no changes once the application is complete, except as specified by the director. And what I'm hearing from the commissioners is you've heard the facts leading up to this point and you're comfortable that 8 days was sufficient. I would be very much on board with that, and I'd be comfortable with you moving forward. But I wanted to bring it to your attention that the dates were relatively close. We'll typically set us that threshold of 15 days because that's not in the ordinance, but it matches up with the state's legal requirement for a legal ad.
How about if we were to hold a public hearing, and if we don't feel that there's sufficient information, we could then delay the decision? How about that?
I'm going to withdraw my motion as well. As you're comfortable with it, and the fact that there's less impact is there more impact, my concern is not really there. Because once our application was approved, and they came back whatever changes they made for less impact, I'm not seeing where I have much opposition, but we'll wait to see.
Maybe we just hold a public hearing on your side at that point, have everybody can weigh in.
Yeah.
We'll abide by your decision. Thank you for the opportunity to speak.
Tom, one other question. Can you elaborate a little bit on what you said, the advertising?
That was just my discussions this afternoon with Ethan. My preference was this came in 15 days prior. That matches up with standard requirement that we run a legal ad 15 days prior, and that similar intent, and it's giving people notice, giving them an opportunity to come in our office and review it.
Are you saying the 15 days is not happening this time? I think you are.
Well, legal ad ran long ago for this because it's already been postponed. The last what I have from the engineering department says that on the 7th of this month is when they got the final product from the applicant, and that's why I brought it to your attention.
I think when you hear the public hearing, you can hear information when they try to appease certain groups with Liberty Smart Growth, and that's why the changes were made. And to punish them for making less impact, it just doesn't seem right.
I wasn't planning on punishing anybody.
Commissioner, may I draw my second first?
Now we'll draw a motion.
Mr. Chairman, motion to adopt the agenda. Did you need another postponement? Oh, I'm sorry.
And we have a motion. We have a motion to adopt.
I'm going to adopt. He withdrew.
Oh, he withdrew.
I didn't know the county would need that.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, I do. Thank you. I'd like to add, if the board will accommodate this, as item number three under new business. And this would be a proposed resolution to authorize the abandonment of certain prominent slope easements. I have provided a copy of the resolution in front of you. This is a time-sensitive matter. And if you will authorize this to go on the agenda by way of no less than a 4/5 vote, I will explain it further when we get to that point in the agenda. Mr. Chairman.
So moved, Council. Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes unanimously.
Thank you.
That's it. Oh, I thought you said if we pass it, you would explain further?
When it gets on.
When you get around it?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Okay, do I hear a motion to adopt the agenda now?
Mr. Chairman, make a motion to adopt the agenda.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Announcements and reports. Are there any announcements or reports? If no one else has one, I have one, which is that there will be a town hall meeting here in this room on March 29th at 6 p.m. organized by Commissioner Levent and myself in order to get input and talk about water and the water contract between the county and the city of Cumming. That's my announcement. Any further? Okay, public comments.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. We would like to take a moment to review the meeting procedures. Please silence all cell phones and electronic devices. Please refrain from disrupting the meeting through general outbursts, applause, or comments. All comments shall be directed to the entire board and not to a particular commissioner. If you have documents with the commissioners, please provide those to the clerk. If fewer than 7 copies are submitted, only 1 copy will be retained by the clerk as part of the permanent record. Those who wish to speak must sign up by completing a public comment or public hearing form available just outside this room. Information regarding specific requirements to address the board is listed at the podium. Please state that information prior to speaking. Per the county's broadcast policy, the county is not responsible for statements made during public meetings and does not warrant the accuracy of such statements. The public comments portion of the meeting is intended to allow speakers to make a verbal presentation to the board. The number of speakers is limited to 10. Speakers are selected on a first-come basis and will be heard in the order in which they signed up, with the exception that Forsyth County residents will be heard first, with non-county residents to follow until the allotted time has expired. Each speaker is limited to 3 minutes. The public comments portion is limited to 30 minutes. With respect to the public hearings portion of the meeting, each side, those in opposition and those in support, are allotted 10 minutes to speak, and each speaker is limited to 3 minutes. Mr. Chairman, there are no speakers signed up for public comment this evening.
Thank you very much. Adoption of the minutes. Chair entertains a motion to adopt the minutes of the work session and executive session February 28th, 2012.
So moved.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Okay, Chair entertains a motion to adopt the minutes of the regular meeting, public hearings, and executive session March 1st, 2012.
So moved.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Chair would entertain a motion to adopt the minutes of the work session and executive session of March 6, 2012.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes unanimously. And Chair would entertain a motion to adopt the consent agenda.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. Okay, we are at just a second. We there a public hearing number one, which I believe we've agreed to proceed with at this time?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, zoning application 2082 is the file for us, and the request is AZ120005, located in Commission District Number 3. This is a public hearing for KM Homes LLC regarding the amendment of Condition 1, placed on Z3082. The applicant is requesting variances to the Forsyth County Unified Development Code Table 11.2B to allow all lots in Brighton New Subdivision to have a front yard setback of 20 feet instead of the required 25 feet, to allow 15 feet between structures instead of the required 20 feet, and to allow all exterior lots to have an exterior yard setback of 45 feet instead of the required 50 feet. The applicant is also requesting a variance to Chapter 18-11.2 to eliminate the stream buffer and impervious surface setback next to state waters. The current version of the proposed zoning conditions are on your screen. The property is located in Brighton View Subdivision on Kelly Mill Road, across from the intersection with Westgate Drive and the zoning West 3 by the Board of Commissioners on June 16, 2005.
Thank you, Tom. Chair would entertain a motion to open the public hearing.
So moved.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of this?
Ethan? Mr. Chairman, members of the Board of Commissioners, Ethan Underwood with Lynch and Johnson Firm on behalf of Kevin Holmes. Again, thank you for letting the public hearing proceed. This is a subdivision just west of the intersection of Bethelview and Kelly Mill Road. What we're hoping is we're going to be seeing more and more of the folks buying up and develop lots, these pipe farms that have been sitting vacant for some time. KM Homes is an excellent developer. They've done a lot of work down in Turnberry, Nichols Road, doing a lot of work on Post Road as well. So they have a great product. They are wanting to acquire the Brighton View subdivision. It is north of the Brighton Lake subdivision. As you can see, there's a lake actually on the site. What we are proposing to do is modify the originally platted 29 lots and reduce that down to 27 lots. We have asked for several variances to accommodate this. One of the issues we're dealing with is this is an old subdivision we're dealing with. When I say old, it's an older S3 that we're dealing with 9,000 square foot lots. The market actually is demanding larger homes, so we're asking variances to be able to put the larger homes on these lots. The first two variances we'll discuss are dealing with state waters. We'll get to the setbacks. We are requesting variances only in very specific places. In fact, have submitted a zoning condition amendment that pegs it to the site plan. So this isn't a carte blanche reduction. We are asking to be able to put an impervious surface only within the 50-foot buffer in this area that's highlighted in blue. The remaining paths will all be impervious surface, so either be mulch or crusher run, something in the water to get there. So there's actually no need for a variance in those particular areas. The two lots that we are requesting variances to the impervious surface setback are shown as lots 7 and 8. I'm sorry, 6 and 8 in the subdivision plat, shown as in the yellow. Just those portions of the property are what will be encroaching to the impervious surface setback. So no portion will encroach into the home will encroach into a 50-foot buffer, but they will just in those sections that are highlighted in black, one on lot 6, and then just a very small corner on lot 8 will encroach to the impervious surface area. And those are the extents of those variances. We're, again, asking to, we'll be preserving the buffer and setbacks along the lake and along the state waters. Again, what we've asked for is to modify the existing zoning condition number 1 so that site plan specifically references the March 1st site plan. The three performance standards variances that we're requesting for the exterior, side, and front yard. The front yards, again, we're asking to put larger homes. You'll still have, we're asking to go from a 25-foot front yard to a 20-foot. So again, the encroachment is going forward. It's not going to push it out on the neighbors. With 20 feet, you'll still have at least 12 feet behind the back of the curb to the property line. So you're looking at 32 feet from the back of the curb, minimum 32 feet from the back of the curb to the front of the home. That's adequate room for sidewalks, and make sure you don't have cars hanging out into those blocks. As far as the side yard goes,
we are again asking to be able to go have 15 feet between the structures, which again, looking at overhang, you probably have about 17 and a half feet from the foundations. We did work with the fire department on this matter, and negotiating this with Captain Shivers and the Chief Bowman, they were very adamant about making sure that we had a 1-hour fire-rated material, that we had offsets and openings in case you did have a fire, you can boil through one house and go to another. And we are submitting a variance condition, which we'll highlight here as well. We just speak with the fire department. Obviously, they can render their own opinion, but our understanding is they had no objections to the proposal, provided the condition was approved. And then finally, the exterior yard setback. We're asking for a 5-foot reduction on the exterior yard. It'll still be 45 feet between the structures and the outside property lines. You can see the exterior here, just on the western, eastern boundaries, and then along Kelly Mill Road. This will help bring in a more extensive product. Homes, in fact, there are zoning conditions that require at least 15 of the homes to have a minimum of 2,200 square foot, and the remaining 12 to have at least 2,400 square foot. The average is going to be actually in excess of 2,600 square feet, exclusive basements and garages. So they're going to be nice homes, they're going to be extensive homes and comparable to the area, but we do need to give the flexibility on this design to be able to have the site taken down and again, now put these back on tax rolls with houses instead of just little pipes to get out from. We did work with Smart Work for Scythe. We met with Jack Leeson. I don't know if he's here tonight, so he can certainly speak for himself. He was very complimentary. One of the changes that we have made, this lot 7, which is shown on the northwest corner of the lake, was actually shown to be two different lots, that there are large caliper trees in excess of 24 inches in diameter apiece, and it made a lot of sense to try to preserve those and make that into a park. So K&M Homes modified its original application, which was for the 29 lots, to remove those and to preserve that as a park. And again, the only encroachment that would be into the stream buffer is for a impervious path to walk down to the dock that we're uploading. With that, we will reserve the remainder of time. We have any questions.
Mr. Underwood, would you go back to the side yard variance setback screen?
With the condition question?
That variance before. Kevin Shivers, have you reviewed that and you're comfortable with that?
We are, Commissioner. We've been working closely with Mr. Underwood's office on this, and I've personally visited the site. We have outstanding positive water in the area, and considering their agreement to use the Class A waste materials, offset penetrations, and considering that just around the corner, literally, the future Fire Station 6 in a few years, we have no objections whatsoever.
Great, thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Thank you.
You need to talk about, anybody else wish to speak in favor of this? Anybody?
Greetings, Honorable Commissioners. My name is Jack Leeson. I live at 1595 Robbins Walk. I'm a concerned citizen of Forsyth County, volunteering my time to be here on behalf of Smart Growth Forsyth County as their environmental compliance officer this evening. The applicant had Ethan Underwood of Lipscomb Law contact us at Smart Growth several weeks ago, asking for consideration of our review of what the applicant had proposed of moving forward in development of this type farm as it stands today. Located on Kelly Mill Road, across from Westgate Drive, which at the time included them seeking complete elimination of the impervious and undisturbed buffers to accommodate an impervious surface walking path, accessing the existing large pond, whose outfall feeds a tributary leading eventually to Big Creek. Thus, for the project's location within both the Big Creek small water supply watershed overlay and its location within a significant aquifer recharge zone, groundwater recharge area, we could not advocate at that time. The project was then significantly revised in a manner that eliminated their need for such an extreme variance, which also, much to our delight, included the cessation of two lots proposed of the original encroachment that, for their cul-de-sac placement, caused a large and irregular sizing and made up at least half of that area still requiring variance, but now only to the impervious buffer. We are pleased about the project, the prospect of this development being completed as such today, as these latest revisions also increase the project's overall percentage of open area green space. Walking the property with the applicant and his counsel this morning allowed Smart Growth Forsyth County the first-hand opportunity to verify the lay of the land being consistent with what has been done out there so far, and two, the viability of what's being proposed being compatible with what we know of the area's environmental sensitivity. We discussed the possibility of the principal providing information voluntarily to the project's homeowners upon purchase that describes the particulars of this area's environmental sensitivity, especially those lots subjective of any impervious surface coverage variance encroachment, and two, then considering the provision of landscape maintenance by the developer versus the individual homeowners in the interest of best providing for the protection of the lake and downstream waterways. Smart Growth seeks to find balanced solutions to those concerns occurring between the development community and those communities being developed in, and we are very pleased to speak in support of this project as drawn today. Thank you. Jack Leeson, SGFCI.
Thank you. Is anyone else wish to speak in favor? Is there anyone here that wishes to speak in opposition to this? Seeing none, is the chair here a motion to close the public hearing?
One second, Mr. Chair. I'd like to know what provisions the engineers added to the zone.
It wasn't conditions, it was just technicalities, particularly. The code requires that when you have any impact into an impervious area, you have to have a certain amount of mitigation on site equal to the impact. And they were just wanting to make sure that all the calculations were correctly shown on the application and the calculations on the plan itself. So we submitted those, and my understanding is they were approved by the engineering department.
Okay, so there's no major engineering problems, it's just calculations.
Making sure we comply with the code.
Okay. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Chief Chair.
Okay. Do I hear a motion now to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Sir.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. That passes unanimously. I think it's District 3.
Light of all the information we received, I feel comfortable in making a motion that we approve the zoning amendment for ZA3082 for the KM Homes LLC, and also the variances as displayed, including variance number 4 set forth by the fire department and their requirements, or their suggested requirements, and as shown on the screen.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? If not, please. Yes.
We just want to clarify that the date on the screen is an old site plan and needs to be updated to the March 1st site plan.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion that the date on the condition shown would be change number 1 there to the March 1st.
Yes, March 1st,
2012. This is included in your first motion.
That's an amendment.
Okay.
Amendment to change that to March 1st, 2012.
And do I hear a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second on an amendment. Please, if there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. That passes unanimously. And now to the main motion. If there's no further discussion on that item, please vote. And that passes unanimously. Old business. Approval for amendments to the Forsyth County Ethics Ordinance. Chairman entertains a motion. Mr. Chairman, do you want me to present recommendation?
Yes, please.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, members of the board, you have in front of you this evening proposed modification to Forsyth County Ordinance 77, the Forsyth County Ethics Code. This is not a public hearing this evening, as the board has already had the required two public hearings. This item is before you for decision only. This would be a modification to the conflict of interest transaction section of the code that would allow for the county to enter into contracts involving services of property with an official or employee or with a business entity in which the official or employee has an interest, so long as five different criteria are met. I'll read them and then I will turn it back over to the board. The five criteria have to be that, number one, the official or employee has no obligation or authorization to take an official act with respect to the contract, number one. Number two, the contract is or was awarded by way of a competitive procurement process. Number three, the employee or official discloses to procurement personnel his or her affiliation with the county. Number four, the employee or official affirms in writing to procurement personnel that he or she has neither solicited nor received any advantage, favor, or influence with respect to the contract due to affiliation with the county. And number five, the contract is not otherwise prohibited by law. This would be a fairly significant modification to the code, as right now there is a bright line rule that would not permit this activity. Mr. Chairman, I think the matter is to the board. Thank you, Counselor. The chair would entertain a motion regarding this.
Mr. Chairman, did you review it? You wanted to delay it last time. Are you comfortable with it now?
I'm not asking you to delay it this time.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion. We approve the amendments to the Forsyth County Ethics Ordinance 77-B as reflected by our attorney.
Second.
We have a motion and we have a second. Is there any discussion? If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 3-2. And we are on to new business. Zoning requests.
That's new business. Item 1A, zoning application 3585. Ron Addison, located District 5. This is a request to rezone from Lake Residential to Industrial M1 on 1.98 acres for an office warehouse with a total building area of 19,500 square feet, 20 parking spaces. The applicant is also requesting variances to the Forsyth County Unified Development Code as follows. Number one, reduction of 45 feet to the 60-foot required side yard buffer to allow a 15-foot side yard buffer. Two, a reduction of 50 feet to the 75-foot required side yard setback to allow a 25-foot side yard setback. The property is located on the east side of Elrod Circle. Planning Commission recommends approval of this rezoning from LR to M1 with the following variances and conditions as shown on your screen. The public hearing was held on February 28, 2012.
Thank you, Tom. This is in District 5, and I would like to make a motion that we approve zoning request ZA-35A5 with variances and conditions as displayed.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there is no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Now at the presentation of the comprehensive plan update. Senior planner.
Good evening. I'm happy to present our full update to the comprehensive plan. We submitted the community assessment and community participation program back in September of 2010 and then proceeded with the community agenda, which encompassed a 15-month public participation process. The last public hearing was held in December 2011. We transmitted it to the state, and they returned their approval in February with no recommendations. changes. So planning staff is asking the board to consider signing the adoption resolution this evening.
Thank you. And thank you for all your hard work.
Thank you. There was an entire team that helped along this process. And I can answer any questions you had about the process or the document.
I just want to echo the chairman's comments. This has been a huge undertaking. I appreciate your leading it up and becoming the whole part.
Just so everybody can see, this is what we're talking about, and it's very nicely done. Chair would entertain a motion regarding this item.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion that the board adopt the resolution. Let me just get to here and read it to me. Adopting a comprehensive plan full update and authorizing and directing the notification of the Georgia Treatment Commission of our adoption of that plan.
Second. We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? If not, we vote on the motion. And the motion to approve the comprehensive plan passes unanimously. Yes, 10. We're at the resolution.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, thank you. This is a modification to the agenda this evening that was done by motion and vote at the time that the agenda was set. Mr. Chairman, you have in front of you a proposed resolution that would authorize the county to commence abandonment procedures with respect to a certain permanent slope easement on property located at the intersection of Post Road and Drew Campbell Road in the northwest corner of that intersection. The property was owned at the time the county acquired it by Bennett Partners LLLP. I believe the principal of that entity is Michael Bennett. And I want to explain what is going on here and why I'm bringing this to the board's attention. Presently, the county, when we acquired property at this intersection, we secured a considerable amount of right-of-way and also permanent slope easement. And right now there is development going on around in that intersection, both future and existing. And there has an issue has arisen, first of all, with respect to whether or not the county owns a certain right-of-way out there, and those are real live disputes that we have with the property owner right now. And also an issue has arisen with respect to the current development plans for a commercial restaurant that is in the permitting stage in the county. And one of the things we're trying to do is work these issues out one by one as we can to avoid litigation. Because right now there is the potential for litigation, and so to the extent that we can do it reasonably and equitably, we're trying to work these issues out. What this would do is this would authorize the abandonment of the permanent slope easement that right now is impacting that development, because the plans for the development anticipate certain permanent improvements in the permanent slope easement. And so for us and my engineering department and the planning department to get comfortable with it and comfortable with the permitting, we need to go ahead and abandon. Now, you can't abandon overnight. There is a process to abandoning. The county paid for this this permanent slope easement. For us to abandon it, there's a process to go through, and we need to trigger that, which is what this resolution would do. The slope easement that we have acquired on this piece of property where this commercial restaurant is slated to potentially be constructed, we originally appraised this permanent slope easement for $18,750. That was part of our acquisition by way of condemnation. Afterwards, while the condemnation litigation was ongoing, we appraised the slope easement again, and the appraisal came in at $28,125, and that was used for ultimate resolution of the case. The county eventually settled the case, and the property owner now is seeking to have us abandon it. But because we can't do that this evening, the property owner has basically come to the county and says, look, I will tender an amount to you, to the county, to hold in escrow that I believe approximates the value the county paid for the entirety of the permanent slope easement, and you hold it, all right, while you commence your abandonment process, and I'll tell you how much I need you to abandon. We acquired 0.375 acres of permanent slope easement, but it is unlikely that we will need to abandon all of that slope easement to resolve the issues. The property owner has said they will tender $62,099.24 to be held in escrow by the Department of Finance. It is unlikely that the ultimate value of what will be abandoned back to the property owner will equal $62,099.24. In fact, it's likely it will be some less than that. But that was a way for the property owner to say to the county, look, I'll tender that in there. If you will release my permits while this abandonment process continues, you can know then that you're financially covered, that the county will be made whole, if you will, by whatever amount is conveyed back to me, and then I can go ahead and permit or allow my commercial development to be permitted, and we won't hold that up and me lose my contract while the abandonment goes forward. Does everybody understand what we're doing here? So in any event, that's what this resolution does. This resolution authorizes the engineering department and my office to commence the abandonment process with respect to that parcel on the northwest quarter of Drew Campground and Kelly Mill Road. That's one thing that it does. It also requires the property owner to tender to the Department of Finance tomorrow sums equating to $62,099 that will be held while we otherwise try to work out these other issues and avoid litigation. Now, once that's done, the permits, to the extent they're being withheld because of encroachments in the permanent slope easement, can be released. And then I will bring back to you at some further time the specific amount of property we need to abandon on that portion. Does anybody have any questions?
Councilor, just want to make it clear so that people don't get the misunderstanding that we're going to abandon it and give it back to the community. He's going to buy it back.
No, that's why they have to make the tender to us. Is
I
because
I just want to make it clear because the term abandon is that we're just going to abandon it.
It's a term of art.
Just to make sure.
Yes, yes, sir. That's correct.
Are you comfortable with this procedure, Councilor?
I am. I mean, I think we have covered our bases, quite frankly, very well. The obvious interest of the county is that whatever we pay for, if we're going to release it, we want to get paid back for it. That covers it. And to the extent we don't want to lose the future commercial development, this makes sure that we allow the permitting to go forward, but we've also got the property owner, quite frankly, the county's covered with respect to the tender of the check and escrow.
Please, Mr. Chair, I'll make a motion to approve this resolution presented by council. Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion? If not, please vote on the motion, which passes unanimously. I have a note here on the previous item that I need some direction or help with. It says that if approved, then the resolution must be adopted. Did I leave out a step on the previous item?
You know you did, because Commissioner Bell specifically adopted the resolution.
Okay, thank you very much. Councilors, is there a need for an executive session?
No need, Mr. Chairman.
Is there any further business to come before this board? Before I ask for an adjournment, I would like to thank Troop 1099 for joining us. And just let you know that as exciting as this has been for you, I'm sure, this is actually a very short meeting. It'll get even more exciting as time goes on. So please come back as often as you'd like. Chair would entertain a motion to adjourn.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. That passes unanimously, and we are adjourned at 5:48 p.m.
so much. Y'all did a great job. Thank you, buddy.
Hey, no, Eric.
Job, great, great.
In a nutshell, sometimes make laws. What that is exactly.
Thank you so much for your help.
It was Andrew. It seemed like he was like 6 months. Like Cal's in eighth grade. No, I think it's fine.
Did you draw the board? Or they just walked?
And he couldn't take a picture. He was like, you got all yours? You came with you?
Yeah, I got it. They're like, he's going home in his bed.
It's not. No, it'd be funny. Like, you say, put your dog, close your mouth, and you're
Ethan, you guys come down to
the table. Okay, let's go. Ted, you wait with us. Ted, come on. You go.